We give you all the praise, we give you the glory. Heavenly Father, we come as your children. We have come to worship you. We have not come to this place, Jesus, seeking a man, but we have come seeking your face. And therefore, Heavenly Father, we humble ourselves. We come before you as your lamb, broken, Lord God, ready to be used by the Master. Help us tonight to sing your praise. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, can we just worship him tonight?
It's when I lift my voice, when my hands are lifted,
power,
in my secret place, it's you I see.
You will always do
that. You are always waiting.
Thank you.
all in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. I love the anointing. I love the power of God. And I think tonight we're going to experience something we've never experienced before. I believe that God is here to touch people. I believe that God is here to refresh people. God is here to give you a fresh vision. God is here to revive you. God is here to stir you up tonight. So if you have an expectation in your heart, just give him the shout of praise. If you are hungry for something tonight. Hallelujah. And I want to welcome my friend. Hey, she's here. Hallelujah. Amen. Your pastor to come on the pulpit. I was told I must just sing. Amen. And I love singing. Hallelujah. Pastor. Like we say in South Africa. Pastor. Come on, give it up for your pastor. Pastor Miriam.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know your amen needs a little bit of anointing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We can do better. Let's lift the roof a little higher. Thank you so much, Pastor Bungari. Thank you so much, Choir. Thank you. And thank you so much for every person that is present here tonight. We don't take it lightly. We welcome all the pastors, all the bishops in the house, all the titles. I want to observe them way, way, way in advance. Amen. We really honor you. We are so grateful that you are here tonight. We don't take it lightly that you have come to support this work from every corner of this nation where you have come from. Pastor Mulia, your coming is from so far out there. We still say thank you so much for traveling that far just to be in our midst tonight and throughout this conference. And we want to say it's a beautiful beginning when we have people that who travel, and not just from afar, but even you that has traveled just within the city, and you've put aside all your programs just to be with us. We don't take it lightly. Thank you so much. Thank you. I think we can give ourselves mighty, mighty clap. Let's just give it up. Your efforts will be rewarded. Your efforts will be rewarded. Amen. There is nothing that you do for God that is going to go into the water and it just disappears. Amen. Everything you sow into God, you will reap it. Amen. I want you to tell your neighbor, if you have sown into God, just know you are about to reap it. If you put God, prepare your harvest. Prepare yourself because God is going to reward you. Every minute, even if it's a second, I have proved God on this one. Amen. I've proved God on this one. I can have a one quarter, but if I give it to God, I will reap a hundredfold. Amen. And there's something that Pastor Benta said today to me, and it shook me. I said, wow. That's amazing. Amen. And he said that every time that you plant into a person, you are not planting it into the ground, you're planting into a soil that is going to build itself, that's going to multiply itself. Amen. And so you know that your being here is a plant into the kingdom of God. And you yourself, you are not alone. There are many that are behind you. Amen. There are so many that you are still bringing in. And remember that if everywhere you stand as an individual, 10 people are looking up to you. No matter whether you know it, you don't know it. I've said it before. As long as you are standing as a human being, there are 10 people that are looking up and saying, I wish I could be like him. I wish I could be like her. And you may not know it, but it's something you need to know at the back of your mind, that you are influencing 10 people unconsciously. But what if you were conscious of the 10 that are influenced by you? Think about it. Amen. If you're conscious of the 10, I'm talking about the unconscious ones, but if you're conscious of only 10, wow, then you know that sooner or later, the time that in each and every one of them are all coming to you, and that's 100 already. Amen. Amen. So tonight, I don't want to take so much of your time. I'm so grateful you're here. And I want us to put our hands together as we welcome to the platform here tonight, all the way from South Africa, our pastor, Pastor Jacques Fenter. Let's put our hands together.
How many of you brought a friend? Let me see, where's your friend? We asked last night that you bring a friend tonight. Who of you brought a friend? Hallelujah, look at those faithful members. Amen. 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 And if you did not bring somebody, I pray that the Holy Ghost conviction hit you so hard that Sunday you will bring 5 people. Amen. Because a Christian that does not reach people is not a Christian. Amen. Because Jesus sent us to be the salt of the world, to be the light in the world. He gave us an instruction, and that is, go and make disciples of all. Okay? The vision of CRC, each one, reach one. If you come with empty hands, you did not fulfill the mission of the church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, don't worry, I'm not fighting with you. I'm trying to teach you the culture of our church. The culture of our church is we never show up to church without a person or without money. Amen? That's the culture of our church. We never show up in church without money and without people. Because people we take to heaven, money, we need to sow it so that we can fund the kingdom of heaven. Amen? Amen. So I hope that each one of you who did not bring a person at least brought a lot of money tonight. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we are not just after money, people. No, we are after souls. We want to see the souls saved of this nation. Okay. Tonight I'm not going to speak long. I'm going to share something short. And then we're going to give over to Pastor Bogani. We've got something specific to do tonight. Something very important to do tonight. That's why I come to Zambia. For this very specific reason tonight. So you're welcome to take your seat. Look at the person next to you, say hello. I hope you're ready. Come on, look alive. Come on, tell them, look alive. You better shout very loud, hallelujah. You better shout out loud, amen, when the pastor is preaching. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
The Bible says that every promise should be proclaimed by a loud yes. Amen. Amen. So when you are in CRC, you find out that people shout, yes, amen. Why? Because the Bible says that's what we do. When you find a promise in the Word and God gives you a promise, you sound it back with a?
Yes.
Ah, come on. You sound back with a?
Yes.
And that's like 2 out of 10. You sound back with a?
Yes.
See, one brother is getting in there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Are you ready?
Amen.
Well, let's get straight into the Word. The Bible says in the book of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to read 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Sorry, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. One chapter on, just next page. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, the Bible says the following. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things has passed away. Behold, all things has become new. Say, all things has become new.
All things has become new.
Come on, preach to your neighbor. Say, all things has become new.
All things
are of God. Who hath reconciled us with himself by Christ Jesus and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. I want to tell you tonight that God is about to do a new thing.
Amen.
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 God is going to do something new in your life. God is going to do something new in this church.
Amen.
And it's already begun.
Amen.
The new thing that he's doing is going to take the focus of the church and is going to bring back his purpose to the church, and he's going to release his purpose in the hearts of the people. And when he releases the purpose of his heart in the hearts of people, then something will happen. God will restore the spirit in the house of God of reconciling people with God and reconciling people with one another.
Amen.
You see, God gave us a ministry. Come on, say, God gave me a ministry.
My ministry
is
to be a minister
of reconciliation.
I am a minister
of reconciliation in the kingdom of God. Do you believe it?
Amen.
I give the Lord a praise for that.
Amen.
The minister of reconciliation. Your first reconciliation to do is between man and God. You see, the cross has got two beams, one going up and down and one going from side to side. The beam that goes up and down is the reconciliation from man to God and God to man. Jesus Christ, when he died, he tore the veil from the top to the bottom, which says that God has come from heaven to earth, so that from heaven to earth, he can reconcile himself with man. Now it is man's responsibility to respond to what God has done. So when I respond to what God has done, I reconcile myself back to God. But not just me and God and me, but me and my brother and my sister. Come on, touch the person on the one side. Touch the person on the other side. God wants to reconcile us from left to right. God wants to reconcile us with him. And God has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Come on, say it again. I have a ministry
of reconciliation.
Hallelujah. So what is my job? My job is to win souls. My job is to bring people to the house of God. My job is to bring people to the house of God so that they can meet God. Not to meet the big bishop, not to meet the big apostle, not to meet the big man of God, the one with the power for the hour, the one that thinks he's all big. No, to meet with Jesus Christ. Because when we come to the house of God, we are there for Jesus. We are not there for a man,
amen,
for a woman. God will use a man and God will use a woman. And tonight you will experience that our God uses a man and a woman. But we are not there for humans. We are here for him, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's why we come to the house of God. And Jesus Christ will use whoever he needs to use to make the work done. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we are here as servants of the Most High God. When we walk into the house of God, I am a servant. I'm not better than anybody else. Pastor Bongani is a servant. Pastor Miriam is a servant. Every single one of the people on the stage is a servant. You are a servant. Now, I haven't seen one servant being more important than the other servant.
Amen.
Because the man that's doing the sound is much as important as I am preaching the word.
Amen.
It's as much as important as the man playing the piano. It's as much as important as the cameraman. Everybody in the house of God has the equal responsibility of making the house of God great.
Yes.
And that's why God is about to do a new thing. He's going to raise up a church in Lusaka that is not going to be an egocentristic church that thinks they know it all. They try to be big. But it's going to be big through people that team together, and together they do more.
Amen.
When people understand that the function in the house of God is what he has called them to do, so that in this house people will work together, they will rally together, and they will get the nation and the city of Lusaka to be born again. Jesus gave us one mission, and that is not to build our own throne, but to win, seek, and save the lost. Amen.
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 So my job, my purpose in this world is to get people born again.
Yeah.
If I don't fulfill my purpose, I miss it.
Yeah.
You see, some people think their purpose is to be a doctor. Some people think their purpose is to be a pastor. Some people think their purpose is to be a musician. Some people think their purpose is to be a veterinary. Some people think their purpose is to be a housewife. Some people think their purpose is to be a businessman. That is not your primary purpose, my friend.
No.
That is your secondary purpose.
Amen.
Your primary purpose is to be a soul winner.
Hallelujah.
Because what does it help you to be the best doctor, but you're not taking people to heaven?
No.
Then you have missed your purpose. You see, that's why you find many people that they are very well educated. They are very high up in the world, but they are never happy. You find people in Hollywood, they've got the whole world at their feet. They've got all the millions, but they are not happy. They want to commit suicide. Why? Because they don't know why they are doing what they are doing. And the very purpose for you to find out why you are doing what you are doing is for you to realize that if you don't win souls, you will never be happy in anything else.
Amen.
You will be happy as a doctor when you start to save souls.
Amen.
You will be happy as a pastor when you make an altar call and save souls.
Yes.
I travel to too many churches to find that people do not make altar calls.
No.
They preach a big message. They collect a lot of offering. But where is the salvation of the souls? You've got many churches, they do deliverance. They drive demons out that doesn't even exist. But they drive out demons, deliverance. But they don't lead people to Jesus. God is about to raise up a new church, a new house.
Amen.
The church that he originally planned, the one that was in the book of Acts.
Amen.
A church is going to do a new thing. It's an old thing, but he's going to breathe upon it.
Hallelujah.
You remember Samson? When Samson walked, he found the jaw of a dead donkey. But the Bible says it was a fresh jaw of a dead donkey. It was a fresh, it was old, it was dead, but it was a fresh, it was never been used before. So he took that fresh jaw of a dead donkey and he killed thousands with that fresh jaw. So God is not going to start a new movement, a new kind of a church. No, he is going to use the same thing that he used in the book of Acts, but it's going to be a fresh movement all across.
Amen.
And this movement has already started. This movement has started 20 years ago in Bloemfontein. This movement has moved across South Africa. It's moved across to Europe. It's moved across Africa. And this movement is the movement that will change your nation. It's a movement that will change your city.
Oh yes.
And this is the movement that God is birthing here today.
Yeah.
The Bible says, behold, I'm doing a new thing. Say a new thing.
A new thing.
You can choose whether you want to be part of the new thing. Because the Bible says you cannot put new wine into old wineskins.
Yes.
And you cannot put old wine into new wineskins. Because it will destroy one another. You cannot come and bring a next generation, but you still sing the same old song that you used to sing when you were 15 years old. You cannot sing the old music and think you're going to be relevant in the new generation. Because if you're going to take the old music and you're going to give it to the new generation will burst, they will die.
Amen.
Many churches wonder, why don't we have young people? Why don't we have young people? It's because your music is still of 1940.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Well, I know I'm preaching good.
Amen.
And the young people is the ones that are shouting the loudest now.
Amen.
That's why in our movement we've got the latest, the greatest, the newest. Because we want fresh wine for fresh people. We want fresh wine for the young generation. If you're not reaching people, something's wrong with your method. You cannot take old wine and put it into new wine skins. You cannot take old stuff and put it into something new. You cannot take the old and put it into the young person, because the old will not work for the young person.
Amen.
It will kill it. You cannot take something that is young and new and you put it into an old system. Well, my daddy used to praise and worship like that. My grandpa used to praise and worship like that. My great-grandpa used to praise and worship like that. So now my child also has to praise and worship like that. You're going to kill him.
Yes.
You're going to kill him.
Yes.
Come on, say it. The Lord is doing a new thing.
The Lord is doing a new thing.
And I will be new wine.
I will
let go of the old. And I will take on the new. I will not sing like I used to sing.
I will
not sing the old songs.
I will sing a new song.
Sing a new song unto the Lord, declares the Bible. Amen. Sing a new song. Make a new sound in the new generation. Hallelujah. I cannot preach like the old people, and I don't want to preach like the old people. Because I am not an old person.
Amen.
If you were a part of the old generation, then you will die with the old generation. If you want a new generation, you're going to have to change. And one thing you will see in CRC, Pastor Miriam, is we will do new things.
Amen.
We will sing the new song that people might say, well, it doesn't work in our culture. I don't care about your culture, because the Bible says, change your culture, change your mind, for there is a new kingdom that is alive. The people will not like it. I don't care if the people like it or don't like it. We will have to sound a new sound. Why does the world always have the best sound? The new sound, but the church always have the old sound. The church has become boring for young people. They won't know when to come to church, because they know we're going to sing that song. And we're going to sing it and it's going to be dead. And then we're going to resurrect it and we're going to sing it dead again. Years ago, we still sing it. You see, you had Joshua and Caleb. Joshua and Caleb, they were fresh, even though they were old. The other people grew old and they died. Because in our generation, we do it this way. You see, the first words, or the last words of a dying church is, we have never done it this way. You will see that in this church, CRC, new things will be introduced here. Because the old used to be better. The new is now CRC. Now the old will try to get into the new. But if the old gets into the new will die. The new will not explode like it has to explode. You cannot get the old into the new. No, the old is dead and gone. It's over. It's finished. That's it. So the old has to die. But now you have to make the decision. Will I die with the old? Or will I be like Joshua and Caleb and I will go with the new? Because you see, the only two people of the generation that entered the promised land, the only two people of that generation that entered the promised land were the people that was willing to do a new thing, that was willing to worship the Lord a new way, that was willing to do and believe for new things. The rest of the people who said, no, we have never done it this way, they all died in the desert. It's your decision today whether you're going to die in the desert. You see, in the desert there's a lot of miracles. There's a lot of miracles in the desert, but the miracles is to sustain you in the desert. In the promised land there is promises. In the promised land there is fruit. In the promised land there is milk and honey.
Come on.
The thing in the promised land, you have to work hard. In the desert you can sit and complain and God will still provide miracles. But if you step into the promised land, God will give you wisdom. He will give you knowledge. He will give you seed. He will give you whatever you need, but you're going to have to work hard.
Yes.
In the new.
Yes.
Say, the Lord is going to do a new thing.
The Lord is going to do a new thing.
A new thing. The Lord is going to do a new thing.
The
Bible says in Joshua chapter 1, now after the death of Moses, my servant, the servant, the Lord came and he passed. And the Lord spoke unto Joshua, and he said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Say, Moses, my servant, is dead.
Moses, my servant, is dead.
Now, therefore,
arise.
Go over the Jordan. You and all these people
unto the land
which I do give them, even to the children of Israel. Tonight I'm here to make a declaration and then I'm done. My declaration is, Bethel has died. You were shocked. You came to a funeral tonight. Bethel has died. It's over. It's dead. It's gone. Bethel is dead. Bethel, my servant, is dead. Now therefore, arise. Come on, somebody stand up. Oh, let me see who's going to move with me. Who's going to stand up? Who's going to stand up? Arise!
Come on!
Arise! 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 Moses is dead. Now arise. Arise. Even you and this whole people. Arise, even you, and all these people. Those who do not want to arise, they want to stay and die in the desert. Because they're happy in the desert. But those who get up, now suddenly some people suddenly realize they're dying. Because they don't want to die. They want to go alive. Amen?
Amen.
My friend, I'm just telling you the honest truth here. Some people will come with you. Some people will die in the desert. Don't worry about those who die in the desert. They have their chance.
Amen.
Now you arise and you go forth. And you do what the Lord has said. Now you have to cross the Jordan. You have to cross into the promised land. And if you're in the desert, things happen by miracles. But the problem is miracles is just enough to sustain you every day. Every day you do just enough, just enough, just enough, just enough. Now God is going to take you to the promised land. The promised land takes hard work, very hard work. But that hard work will give you more than enough, more than enough, more than enough. enough. God will not just give you seed to sow. He will not just give you bread to eat in the desert, but He will give you seed to sow.
Amen.
God will give prosperity to you when you say, it is over, it is done, it is finished. Those who come with me will come with me. Those who stay will die. And they will die, they will be separated. The word death means to be separated from. So they will be separated from your fellowship. They will be separated from your community. They will not be part of you anymore. Because it's dying. Moses is dead now. Now arise. They tell us dead, it's gone now. It's over, it's finished. That's why I came. I came to tell you that. Because when Pastor Miriam came, she decided to be just like Joshua and Caleb in CRC Pretoria. She saw and she realized this is the promised land. This is the promised land, and yet she had to come back to the desert. And she made a decision and she said, I'm going to change this church from Bethel and we're going to become CRC because that's the promised land we're going to go become. We're going to be like that. It takes a lot of sacrifice. It takes a lot of guts. But she made the decision, and a year ago she already told you we're going to become CRC. And today, I'm here for the funeral to say goodbye. And I am here to say, arise, CRC. You've had the time to transition. Now it is time to work. Now it's time to occupy the promised land. Now it is time to put your hand to the plow and not pray for miracles, but to work your miracle. It is now time. You see, miracles is just God's rescue plan. Some churches just run after miracle, 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 miracle. I'm too tired of people always want a miracle. Oh, I want a miracle. Oh, I want a miracle. Oh, I want a miracle. Why do I want a miracle if I can live in divine health? Why do I want a miracle of healing if I can live in God's plan and His divine health? Why do I want a miracle of my financial breakthrough if I can live in God's divine provision?
Yes.
But you see, a miracle is easy because I beg. But the promise is difficult because I have to work the promise. I have to work the promise. I have to work it. I have to plant seed. I need to water the seed. The seed will grow. And then I have to pick the fruit. It takes work.
Yes.
But I will be living in the promised land. So I am here to announce to you that CRC will not be the easy way, just living from miracle to miracle. No, it's going to be taking hard work from every single member. You can take your seat. He says, my servant is dead, now arise, even you and this whole nation, unto which I have promised you. I'm yet to proclaim to you and to tell you tonight that the change has come. The change has come. These people are elected by God. It takes a bold step to say we will go to the next generation. We will not die with the previous generation. There's one thing you will learn about CRC. We always go for the next generation, next generation, next generation. So tonight we are here to pray and to release your pastors, Pastor Yoram and Pastor Miriam, to release them as the senior pastors of CRC Lusaka today. Today we are birthing CRC Lusaka. Now listen to me. Other people ask me, so why do we favor them? Because in 1 year, I gave an instruction last year. Listen, you have to listen carefully today. Everybody need to listen very carefully today. Because it's on your obedience that something will happen. It's on your obedience that something will happen. If you are obedient, things will happen in your life. If you are disobedient, it will not happen. 1 year ago, I said to all the CRC leaders in Zambia, I was in Kitwe, I said to the CRC leaders in Zambia, I said, if you will do as we say, not that we are the boss and you must do what we say, no. If you do according to what we believe, then you will see the hand of God upon you. If you will give us every Sunday your attendance, your first time visitors, and your salvations, if you do it every week, consistently, continuously, you bring it to us, continuously, every week, we see what is happening in the house of God, then we will see your faithfulness, and through your faithfulness, we will be faithful as well, because your faithfulness will produce for you. And then I see people are faithful. Your pastors here in Lusaka was faithful every single week to give report of what is happening in the house of God. And because of faithfulness, the Bible says, faithful over little, I will make you ruler over much.
Amen.
But Like you cannot just be now a ruler over much and then you are not faithful over the little. Because tomorrow you're going to wake up and it's going to be the same people. It's going to be the same thing. But there's going to be a new fresh anointing. A new fresh spirit upon you. And you will experience it and you will walk in it. Because the favor of God is upon you. Because today it's been released upon you. One of you that is partnering with these people, these chosen people of God, will experience the prospering blessing of the Lord upon you. Because now they can do what I am doing. They can do what Pastor Art is doing. You will be able to do what I am doing. You will be able to do what they are doing. Why? Because we are all partnering together.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know some are getting sad, some are getting mad, and some are getting glad. I'm here for those of you that get glad. Those of you that get mad, hallelujah. God bless you. Bless your enemies. Love them and persecute them. Because you see, God gives you enemies to promote you.
Amen.
If there was no enemies, there was no promotion. But God gives you enemies to promote you. Because they will irritate you until you find the solution. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
So I'm here tonight to come and to pray for our pastors. I'm here to declare tonight that CRC Lusaka is birthed today. To every other CRC pastor, I'm here to tell you this. Stay faithful, stay faithful, stay faithful, stay faithful. Because through your faithfulness, I have seen these people come to the women's conference. I have seen them pay the price to come to the advance. I have seen them pay the price to come to Dream Week. And I have seen their faithfulness every single week, how they are faithful. And God rewards faithfulness.
Amen.
Now some of you might think, hallelujah, the pastor has given them a lot of money. No, I'm not giving them any money. No, I don't. What? No, we're not here to give money. No, because if I give you money from South Africa, you will never learn to raise your own finances.
Amen.
You will always wait for me to give. No, what I give you is I give you the blessing, I give you the name, I give you the support, I give you all the prayer that you can need. But when it comes to the finances, you will believe just like I believe. When I went to my church in Uppington, Pastor Art did not give me a fat check and say start the church. He said to me, if you are called, it will work. If you are not called, it will not work. Now go. Now I'm there, 8 years later. And you can look at my church. 750 members. Every Sunday, almost 300 people in the church. Every Sunday. It's through faithfulness. It's because God has called me. Not because Pastor Art has given me money. No. No. So if that is your motive, you will crash. If your motive is to win souls, to win people, you will be blessed.
Amen.
You will receive the glory of the Lord upon you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you blessed tonight?
Amen.
Well, I'm going to ask right now that we will pray for our pastors. So I'm going to ask Pastor Miriam, Pastor Joram, will you please come to the front? And then I'm going to ask all the leaders, all the other leaders that is working with these two men, a man and woman, working with them consistently, I need you to come and join them on the stage. So all the other leaders, let them quickly come. Let them quickly come. If that's you, quickly, come, 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 come. If I say quickly, it's quickly. Come stand with them.
See you high.
is alive in this place. Celebrate. It was not a set day. It was a celebration. Amen. It was a set. Sometimes even if you don't understand what we are saying, just lift your hand and wave. Amen. Just smile and wave. Just smile and wave. You will ask your neighbor later, what are they busy with? Smile and wave. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It was not a funeral. And it was not easy for Joshua to take over. It was never easy. And we not say IHCRC is the best church in the world. No! But your leader has decided. Are you for your leader? Or you were for the church? That's the question tonight. Are you for your leader? Do you believe in these people? I'm asking you leaders. Do you believe in these people? Do you think they had God to join CRC? Or maybe they ate too much pizza? So we see you high and lifted up, shine the light of glory, pour out your power. What God is going to do in this place. You might be here tonight and you see the small thing. I don't see the small thing. You know what I see? How many people is in the city of Lusaka?
3 million.
3 million? 3 million? You all agree? 3 million people in Lusaka? Amen? Amen? 4.5? Even more? Hallelujah. So you know what is the vision of our church? The vision of our church is to have one tithe of this city. Because God believes in the tithe, He believes in 10%, and He says, you bring 10% to me. You bring your tithe into the storehouse. Now we're going to see CRC Lusaka is going to have how many? 450,000 members in Lusaka. Shoot. Sure. Another church and you say, now what about us? Well, you can also have 450,000 and there will still be 70% left.
Come on.
80% left. Okay? We said to God, we will take responsibility and we will bring to you, Lord, at least one tithe of the city. Now listen, CRC pastors, listen, because you might be in Lusaka and say, what's this? If you pay close attention, we will not fit 450,000 people in one building. They will be having multiple camps, sites. In one city. In Bloemfontein we have two already. So we can do the same in Lusaka. One on the east, one on the west, one on the north, one on the south. Why not? And you can be that pastor if you are faithful. Because faithfulness promotes you. Hallelujah. So we believe it. We believe in 450,000. It's easy. Hallelujah. I know when Daniel Kulenda was here a few months ago, there was already 250,000 people there. Which tells me people are hungry for Jesus. But there were still millions. That was still at home. We are here to win the lost at any cost. Hallelujah. Come on. I want all the leaders just to stretch out your hands. Everybody else, stretch out your hands to your leaders right here. Pastor Bongani, please come and pray with me. Father, we thank you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, you said that we separate them unto you by the laying on of hands. Father, we pray right now that you will come and separate them from the work of this ministry. Thank you, Father, that all this dead and gone. Now you say, rise! Your light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Arise and cross over. Arise into the promised land. You will work hard, but you will have great pleasure. You will work hard, but you will receive great reward. We pray for them in the mighty name of Jesus. We agree. We release the anointing. The same anointing that is upon us. The same anointing that deemed them together with us. We pray for the same spirit of excellence. We pray, Lord Jesus, for the same mindset. That there is no quit. There is only overcoming. Because we are more than overcomers through Christ Jesus. We anoint them right now. We bless them right now. We separate them unto you. We pray the fire of the Holy Ghost upon both of them. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Lord, you're going to do mighty things. Thank you for the venue. We declare that that venue has favor. We will have a new venue. Because it's a new church. A new venue. A new world. Hallelujah. New. New.
New.
New. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, we pray for every one of these leaders, in the name of Jesus, that they will stick with their leaders, that they will stay with their leaders, that they will follow their leaders, in the name of Jesus, and they will not turn to the north, or the east, or the west, but they will follow their leaders. They will not look left or look right, and they will not put their head to the plow and look back. They will be prosperous because of their leaders. In the name of Jesus, we declare the fire of the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father, that it will not be old wine, but it will be new wine. I pray for many young people that will start to join and rally behind them in the name of Jesus. That they will sing a new song to the Lord, that they will move with the new of the Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. 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 I pray, I ask you, every other CRC pastor here, that you don't become jealous, but you start to support and you start to pray. Amen. That this church will be blessed. Every single one of us are blessed because of them. We don't get jealous. We celebrate together. When Pastor Kongani does well, I don't get jealous. I get happy because we are part of the same church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just lift your hands and worship the Lord for a moment. We worship you, Jesus.
Come on, sing it!
Oh, you will sing.
Hallelujah. You say the gene, you say the word. Hallelujah. God, I am a born again believer.
Amen.
And tonight, maybe a small message for me that I want to maybe leave it with you as we step into greater things, as we step into new things.
Amen.
One thing that I've learned before I even got married was, even though I decided to get married, Pastor Nelson,
yes,
when the day came, I had fears. I was afraid. I didn't know what my future had for me. Even though I could read the Bible that the Lord has given me, not the spirit of fear, but has given me the spirit of fire, spirit of power, spirit of love, spirit of a sound mind. But when the time came that I had to go into marriage, I was scared. And you know very well, when the time came that I had to join CRC, the same torment came. I didn't know what the future held for me. I was afraid. I kept on asking myself questions. I wonder, what will this white man do with me? When I was honest enough to ask the white man, some of you are not even bold to ask those things. What is this white man all about? And I see CRC is clever. They brought a little bit of a black man next to him. The unstoppable force has come.
Amen.
The power is here.
Amen.
When I had my firstborn son, even though I prayed for him, I'm going to help someone here. Because I prayed for people and I couldn't deserve. When my firstborn son came, even though I prayed for him, even though I had all the medical aid prepared, I was prepared. We bought the cot, we had things for the baby. We were ready, but when the time came, suddenly I had questions. Because now, the whole thought of me becoming a father became a reality. Suddenly I was asking myself questions, is this thing going to work? Am I going to be a great daddy? Or am I just going to be like my dad? How am I going to do this thing? I mean, I don't eat my vegetables. How will I teach my son to eat vegetables? All the questions came. The fear of the new. The fear of the unknown. When my daughter came. When the daughter came, I said to my wife, I've been here before. Even though Satan came and asked me, are you going to be a good father? I had 6 years experience.
Yeah.
Oh, you missed a good place to say amen. You missed it. That is why when my anniversary came, my 10th anniversary when it came, it was not a fearful experience for me. I did not have to ask myself whether I'm a good husband or not. Because I had already dealt with those questions 10 years ago. When the other years came, I did not have to deal with the same person. Because it was no longer new. Yes, it was a new season, a new era. But I understood that this is the church of Jesus Christ. This is the same wife that I had. The new is the season. The new is the season. And I moved from Bloemfontein to the place called Polokwane. It's right on the north of South Africa. It's one of the most beautiful places you can ever visit. They call it the Eden of Southern Africa. I didn't send myself there, God sent me.
Yeah.
It is the best place in the world.
Yes, I guess.
2015, when I had to move, Pastor Jean, there were conflicts in my heart. Because I've been with Bloemfontein for 18 years. Since I came to be a student, then I found a wife, then I built a family, I built a career, and then time came, I had to move. I had to stop relationships of 18 years. I had to stop talking to people that I used to talk to for 18 years. Something has to change.
Yes.
I am very relevant for you. I know your fears. I was there. And the lion landed in Polokwane. I want to tell you right now, God knows your number.
Yes.
Whether it starts with +27 or 0, God knows it.
Yes.
You don't need to think God is frustrated with your situation. Some of you have been believing God for great things.
Uh-huh.
And those things have not been coming because you think God can't. keeps on getting you on voicemail. I want to tell you this tonight.
Yes.
When God has your number, He's got your number.
Yes.
You just have to embrace the new. The Bible says in Philippians, brothers, I don't count myself as apprehended. But one thing I do, forgetting those things that we have, and then I press into the future that the Lord has for me. One thing you have to understand, your past will never be better than your future, but your future is better than your past. You have to embrace what God has for you. Or by the top of your feet and say, hallelujah! How many people are trapped to the darkness because they are afraid of the new? The title of my message tonight is All Things Went Together for Good. The bad, the good, and the ugly, they all went together for good. Even the new, that you don't know what God is going to do. God is going to work it out for the good, just for you. Open the Bible to Romans chapter 8 verse 28. It's a very well-known scripture. But yet when people go through challenges, when people go through storms, I mean, if you've been married for 1 week, you understand that your wife changes every single Monday. When the bitch likes chocolate, she says, what is I don't like chocolate in this one of the Zambian languages? I don't like chocolate in the next chocolate. They call it a chocolate. She didn't call it a chocolate. She didn't call it a chocolate. You come the next Monday, where's my chocolate? Last week you told me you don't like chocolate. This week you say you like chocolate. 3 weeks down the line, I want high heels. Next week, can you keep them low? Our wives, they change all the time, but for alert. And so is your God. The Bible says He's the same yesterday and today. He's the same, but His methods, His way of doing things. Listen, God will not give you manna from heaven today. I'm gonna encounter new demons. I'm gonna encounter new problems because I'm stepping into the new. Hallelujah. Yes. Now, one thing you have to remind yourself is that all things, the good, the mistakes I've done, the people I have around me, the relationships I had, the power and the anointing that I used to possess, they all work together for the good, for now and tomorrow. You have to keep on reminding yourself. They quickly forget. Maybe I should read the Bible, Pastor Jack, I'm not sure. Who loved the Tutsi so? But the other that said once, who gave my little son of the count? That's it, that means you don't hear everything that I've said tonight. Good. Because he, yesterday, spoke his language and said we should not be interpreted to. You still remember? But he was joking, of course, and I am joking also in Africa today. You don't need to think now. Are you there? Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Read it with me, New King James Version. The Bible says, and we know. Isn't that powerful? That opening statement only says, and we know. Paul is talking to people who have gone through the new before. Paul is talking to people who might about the year. What am I going to do? He says, and we know. In other words, we've gone through this before.
Amen.
Come on, get it. Get it with me. And we know that all things, meaning even this, shall pass also. Whatever you are facing today, we know that all things, not some of the things, I know that God can, you know, nothing is impossible with God. body. Hey, Pastor, I know all things are possible with God, but you know this thing of tithing? What do you mean? I know, Pastor, that all things work together, you know, but HIV. I know, Pastor, that all things are possible with God, but tuberculosis. What are you saying? Are you saying your God is limited? Are you saying there are things that God cannot? Let me tell you about my God.
In hunger and in thirst, in fastings often, in cold.
responsibilities, my deep concern about church. What did I read now? I just read all the challenges that Paul used to go through. At the age of 30, they had to put him out, hang him and put him in a basket for him to escape the death of the people that he tried to help. He was shipwrecked. They beat him up, the Jews. Not because he was a criminal, because he was trying to help people. Paul suffered so much. And then he comes to the book of Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 28. He says all things. Are you serious, Paul? You just gave us a list how you've been abused. I see that married wife that gets abused by the husband. And the pastor says, why don't you just leave this husband? And she says, but all things. And then one day you meet with them 5 years later, they are the happiest couples in the world. And then she looks at the pastor and says, I told you. Tonight. I don't care where you come from, whether you've got a poor background or you've got a rich background. I was a street kid. Me. That's why I picked them up and locked in Bulgari. But somehow God draws to who you are. And it's right. Pastor is right. You don't come in with a suitcase of money. Because there's no solution in money. Money will not give you what you want, believe me. The cars that you desire, they will not give you the satisfaction that you are looking for. You can marry 50 times. I sent an aeroplane coming here, Pastor Rose. Next to me there was a 75-year-old professor. 75 years. He overheard us speaking the gospel, the good news. And he was just interested and he said, I want to hear what you're talking about. Now you don't do that to the pastor. I gave him 40 minutes of sermon. I even did not eat, ask him. You don't ask a pastor when he's talking about Jesus, what are you talking about? You are finished. When the aeroplane landed, his name was written in the left book of